This Tibet House video was originally recorded at Menla Retreat in Phoenicia, New York, March 2017. To learn more about this annual program, please visit menla.us.
Should be very, make them very gloomy and morbid, but meanwhile, the Tibetans are very individualistic and happy-go-lucky, incredibly so. And so it's the opposite effect, actually. And then I realized, of course, societies don't want the individual members of the society, authoritarian societies, militaristic ones, do not want them to think of their own death as a reality they will inevitably encounter, because that would make them insist on living more meaningfully. And they wouldn't necessarily serve in this industrial, like doing this rote action or planting the seed or slaving away for that person or the other. They wouldn't want to serve an army and get killed over some nonsense like war over oil or something. They would refuse. And they would be much more individualistic. So being aware about death makes you much more alive. Because you read every moment that you're not dead, you're alive. And that's something amazing, very fragile and very impermanent. So it's a very healthy thing to think about. Anyway.
Well, on that note.
Well, then, you know, on that note, also, then in the sleep yoga, you can imagine when you fall asleep that you're practicing letting go. And you're practicing to live in a way where you're sort of not so clutching onto your life and more open, you know, and therefore more, not so afraid of death, you know, more aware of it, or yes, it will happen, okay, it will be like this. And actually, death is quite a blissful experience when one gets past the clutching phase, which often happens depending on if someone is not. That's why also a thing that people who prepare to die, they give away everything, so they have nothing to be attached. Gaelic Rinpoche tells a story about one of his teachers who was almost highly developed through the Vajra Yogini practice, which is one thing, and another session on the Great Mother, we'll talk more about that, about it, where you visualize yourself as this red, powerful Dakini goddess, Buddha, female Buddha, actually, not just a Buddha goddess. He said his guru came to see him in the hospital where he was, and he said, well, why aren't you dead yet? You should be gone now. And the rainbow body practice is where their body actually physically leaves the bed, leaving behind some hair and fingernails and things. Uh-huh. No, seriously, there's such a thing. You should be gone. Why are you lying there? The guru came and said to his guru. I guess he wasn't there. He just heard the story. And get up and check. And then he looked at him and he noticed he was wearing a very elegant shirt made of Chinese silk with that button the way Tibetans have, you know, like kind of the nice sleeves and the silk lining, brocade lining, and the silk cuff, you know. And he said, where did you get that shirt? He said, oh, someone gave that to me. And I went, oh, take it off, you know. So he made him take off the shirt and give it away, you know, and then he disappeared. He had some attachment to the shirt. Somehow he was still into that shirt. Tell that story.
You could look at it another way. That the shirt. What? You could look at it another way, which is the shirt was keeping him alive.
Well, yeah, but he was ready to go. I mean, he just left with his body. Rainbow body is where you go with your body, and
right.
it becomes a young body in the Dakini land. Yeah. It's a very mystical thing, there, yeah. Boy. Very mystical thing. Sure. And, you know, his body was finished. He was ready to go. You know, people. If you read the near death experience literature, which is very useful to read, a lot of you may probably have.
Yeah.
But one thing you know from that literature is that when people get past a certain stage in the dying process, they don't really want to come back.
Yeah.
They're not really interested in it. And that was a little. You know, there's this thing about the Buddha's mother. He gave birth to the Buddha, could have asked for an easier childbirth. She leaned against a tree and he just came out, you know, morphically through the skin, you know, without any incision or cutting or wounding of any kind. And then he walked around and said, I'm the greatest thing on 2 feet. That's Buddha's first words. I'm the best thing on 2 feet. That's what he said. You know, a small child, instantly right out of the womb. But then she sort of never came back to the, and then her husband came, and then she said, look, I'm not coming back. My sister will raise the boy, and she'll be your queen. And she had a beautiful sister too, you know. And then you know, everyone always worries about it in the history of Buddhism. What happened to Buddha's mother? Maybe it wasn't really this easy birth. It was a terrible one. You know, what? You know, maybe the psychologist like Mark F., my dear friend Mark F., he thinks Buddha was traumatized from birth because of that. Even though he had like 60 foster mothers or whatever, you know, there was a prince beloved by birth. But they think it was a trauma, you know, which it wasn't. But then there is one text, the Avatamsaka, the Garland Flower Ornament Sutra, where she says, I just go down to give birth to the Buddhas. Then I leave and I come back to some heavenly place. I don't really need the infrastructure down there. Coming, you know, I don't go for it, she said. Even king or queen or whatever I may be, I go to give birth to Buddhas. That's what I do. In the universe, I go to many planets and give birth to the Buddhas. Are ready to be Buddhas in their last life. I will give birth to them. That's Maya Devi. You know, Maya means magic.
Yeah.
So the goddess of magic. That's magical.
She's reincarnated all the time.
That's what she does. What?
She's reincarnated all the time to do that?
Yes. That's her only purpose.
She's
a Buddha herself. She's a Buddha herself, but she's part of the. She's the. You know, she goes there to give birth to a kind of humanoid Buddha on a certain planet at a certain time to deliver a message that will last for so many thousands of years. You know, it's like her cosmic job. She, you know, it's just bliss for her. If you read her description of her samadhis in the Garland Sutra, you would not believe it. You really wouldn't believe it. It's so.
So many goddesses to explore.
Oh, incredible.
Yes. So many faces of the goddess.
Oh. something that next time I will read you from. There's the 10, what they call night goddesses. And they are from stages 41 to 50 of the 52 stages of attaining perfect enlightenment in that particular text, where they divide the stages. And the samadhis and the teachings given by these 10 goddesses are the culminating, at the very, very end of almost attaining enlightenment. They're the culminating stages. They're amazing. Nobody pays any much attention to them, actually. In the sort of male Buddhist world, they don't. They have the earlier 10 stages, they pay a lot of attention. And the little tiny incremental stages in the last part, where she is involved, they don't pay attention. Okay, so I think let's do a full circle. Can we do a full circle since this is my last circle?
We're going to do a full circle.
Okay.
This video was brought to you in part through the generous support of the Tibet House U.S. membership community. To learn more about the benefits of Tibet House membership, please visit Tibet House U.S., including invites to special trips to study Buddhism up close and personal with Robert Thurman during his annual geographic expedition trips. Trips in 2018 include Mongolia and Bhutan. To learn more, visit bobthurman.com.